All right, welcome to the Santa Barbara City College Board of Trustees special meeting for Monday, April 11th, 2022. And I'm going to go ahead and call this meeting to order. I'm going to use this gavel because I have not had a chance to use a gavel since I started this presidency. So woohoo! It's lovely for everybody to be here in person. And let's begin with the Pledge of Allegiance. If you please rise and join me. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. And to the Republic which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, liberty, and justice for all. Next up is our roll call. And I'll note that this is a hybrid meeting and we have Trustee Veronica Gallardo joining us via Zoom. So she is online. Hello, Trustee Gallardo. And Trustee Everett has not joined us at this time. And student Trustee Turner Diallo is not with us. If Trustee Everett, knock on wood, hopefully she'll join us. But if not, I know that she'll watch the meeting later and catch up on what we talked about. Welcome everybody. So this is a special meeting where we're talking about fostering equitable, inclusive, respectful, participatory, and supportive communities here at Santa Barbara City College. And we have some wonderful experts to talk with us from San Diego State. I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Murillo to introduce.
Okay. It's on. Thank you. Can you hear me? All right, great. So thank you. And I want to say thank you to our two guests today, Dr. Frank Harris III and Dr. J. Luke Wood, who have joined us from the Community College Equity Assessment Lab and Coral Learning to help us as a college and help provide us a framework for moving forward to become a more socially just and inclusive college. And we're going to have to do the work through diversity, equity, inclusion, and anti-racism. So originally, when I asked them to join us to help, they asked if they could meet with the Board of Trustees in person. And thank you so much for agreeing to be with us today. And I'd like to at least give you a little background around both Dr. Frank Harris and Dr. J. Luke Wood. Dr. Frank Harris is a professor of post-secondary education, senior strategist, student council affairs, and campus diversity co-director, Community College Equity Assessment Lab, San Diego State University. Dr. J. Luke Wood, who just walked in, is Vice President for Student Affairs, Campus Diversity, Chief Diversity Officer, and Distinguished Professor of Education, Co-Director of the Community College Equity Assessment Lab. They have already worked with our faculty here at Santa Barbara City College, and we are very excited about the work they've done, and we are excited that they're here to work with us. I'm surprised they're still standing because we have been in meetings since 9 o'clock this morning. So they've been listening to various employee groups, and we will continue to have some more meetings. With that, I would like to turn it over to, is it Dr. Wood or Dr. Hare, or both? So.
Thank you very much for having us here. We're glad to be here today to talk with you all about the work that we've been doing, and also what we've been engaging with in terms of conversation with individuals throughout the day. A very robust schedule in the most positive of the senses in terms of being able to understand some of the challenges and opportunities as it relates to equity. As was mentioned, I'm Luke, and I'm from the Community College Equity Assessment Lab in CORA. And my colleague, Dr. Harris, here as well. And the title of our presentation to you today is Creating a Socially Just College Through Diversity, Equity, Inclusion, and Anti-Racism. Oh, there we go. And I think you already saw that information, lots of and titles in addition to the work that we do as faculty members at San Diego State. So in terms of the work that we do and the way that we approach thinking about challenges facing student success, facing the effectiveness of an organization, we think about it through the lens of what is referred to as equity. And many of you may have seen pictures of people standing on different size boxes at a baseball game or different size ladders beneath the tree. There's lots of different ways of demonstrating it. But essentially, equity is when we have a heightened focus on groups that experience disproportionate impact. Now, that term, disproportionate impact, means that when you look at outcomes, whether it's student persistence, achievement, attainment, transfer, whether it's campus climate, whether it is representation of faculty, that essentially whatever the average is that we find certain groups who are beneath that. And ultimately, we have a heightened focus on those groups in order to address those concerns, in order to be able to have a heightened focus on them and their success.
We're just going to welcome Trustee Everett for just a moment.
It was an accident on the highway. Sorry.
Very good to meet you. I'm Luke Wood. In order to remediate disparities in the students' experiences and their outcomes, it's intentional that we talk about the students' experiences and outcomes rather than the students themselves or their families or their communities. From the work that we've done for many years now, what we often find is that when there are breakdowns in student success and student performance, that is more often than not a function of the institution and the educators within it, and that there are oftentimes more things that we can be doing. Now, that doesn't say that there are not challenges that students experience, such as food insecurity, housing insecurity, transportation concerns, employment barriers, working conditions. All those are real, true barriers that many students do face. But we often find that when we focus on what's within our own control as educators, that those things are far more effective in actually being able to address the equity gaps that we talk about. Now, there's lots of student groups that experience this disproportionate impact, these outcomes that are lower than that of their peers. It includes our racially minoritized students. Often when we look at data, that includes Black, Latinx, Native American, and Pacific Islander students. And for those campuses that also have higher populations of Southeast Asian students. But we also find that this can be common among people who are current and former foster youth, such as myself, those students who experience basic needs, students with disabilities, students who've been justice impacted. Maybe they have themselves at some point been incarcerated or have close family members, like parents who have been, but there's some sort of involvement with the criminal justice system. We also find that there is large intersections between these groups in terms of students who, for example, may be former foster youth are also unfortunately more likely to be justice impacted. And so there's intersections with those identities as well. When we had a chance in preparation for our visit today to try to have an understanding of the context of which the campus is situated in terms of student outcomes. And when we look at the data, the most recent data that's available through DataMart, we see that there is a 71.4% success rate in terms of classes that were taught via distance. Now, course success, right, is not necessarily course retention, right? So it's not just a student staying in the course, but it's them getting a passing grade and doing well enough to be able to move on really to that next class. We then can look on this screen, and what we've done is we've used kind of a color coding system that is really meant to make it easier to understand what you see. Now, essentially what is red on my computer, but pink up here, is students who have outcomes that are essentially lower than that of their peers. What is green is essentially students who have outcomes that are at the average or above the average or only far enough below it that it would be of a concern. I mean, negligible, and then there's yellow can be kind of somewhere in the middle. Now, some of these I can see already got turned a little bit, but ultimately what we know is that your African-American, Native American, Latinx, and Pacific Islander students are having outcomes that are lower than that of their peers. When we look at this rates over time, what you'll see, for example, with African-American students, and this is African-American females first, you'll see that their data has outcomes that are far below either the total average or the distance average. And that has been a pretty consistent pattern since 2017. Now, I think that's an important point, and here's why. Often people will say, well, hey, these things are a function of the pandemic, right? And certainly students struggled more during the pandemic, and that is understandable. That student of every background struggled more during the pandemic. But it's also to say that the equity issues weren't made because of the pandemic. They preceded it, and they also continue through to this day. When we look at male students, we also see similar results, though I will say that across the board, your male students are where primarily the disproportionate impact is mostly centered, not all of it, but most of it. That is also common from what we see when we look across the state and across the nation, that men overall, and then men of color in general, have outcomes that tend to be lower than that of their peers. There's lots of reasons why that occurs. Here's just a couple quick examples. And then when Frank gets up, he can also offer some from the, in terms of male socialization as well. But we oftentimes know that when we're talking about men of color, they're concentrated into jobs. So work conditions outside of college that have some typical characteristics. Typically they're in jobs that are physically demanding, moving boxes, digging ditches, stocking shelves, doing construction site cleanup. Second, they're in jobs that occur late at night. So they either work the late night shift or overnight shift. Very common for us to interview students who say they get off work at 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the morning. And we ask them, what time is your first class? And they say 8 a.m. Or they're in jobs that are temporary jobs or transitory jobs. So they're in a job for a period of time. They're out of that job and another job for a period of time out of that job. Their jobs also tend to be very disconnected from their actual fields of study. When we look at that in comparison to other students, we don't find those same characteristics to be as prevalent, though that of course can be for all of our community college students. Another thing that we see is a pretty common pattern are issues of how they are viewed by educators. And we refer to it as the D3 effect, distrust, disdain, and disregard. And distrust is sometimes when educators see them, they assume that maybe they have some sort of malintent or they are criminalized in some sort of type of way. And this doesn't begin in a community college, it begins in the earliest levels of schooling. And in fact, a lot of the research that I've done over the past 3 years, or 5 years rather, has focused primarily on preschool through third grade, where we see significant overrepresentation of these same students, but of course at younger levels, in suspensions, loss of recess, expulsions. And so it's just really a continuation of some of those same patterns that we see earlier. The second is what we refer to as disdain. Many of you may have heard that. It's really referred to as kind of deficit perspectives, statements that assume that they're lazy, they don't care, they're not really committed to school. And then the third is disregard, where they're assumed to be sometimes by some educators as academically inferior. We believe that it's important to communicate that you have high expectations for a student's ability to be able to succeed. We oftentimes say, we said in one of our sessions today, that no one has ever risen to low expectations. So it's important to have a high expectations and high rigor. And that's actually the formula that leads to greater levels of success. You'll see that for in-person classes, a lot of the patterns end up being very similar to what we were talking about earlier. I'm just gonna skirt past this because the data itself generally follow the same pattern. Your disproportionate impact groups are primarily your students of color. And with that, it's much more centered on your men overall, in particular your men of color, primarily your African-American, Native American, Pacific Islander, and Latinx students. And we think that this is important because in context of the national climate, we know that students everywhere have a greater level of exhaustion than normal. And I will say this too, also that is true for many of the educators who work with them, because COVID-19 was a very intense period. And if we think about the past 2 years, COVID-19 did two things. One, it bore disproportionate infections, loss of life, and unemployment in minoritized communities. Students who would have normally been able to go and be bedside with a loved one as they were passing from this life to the next weren't able to do so. Students who had family members who were lost would usually be able to go and be in a wake or a funeral. They weren't able to do so. So that natural ability to be able to process a loss of life and be able to engage in those healing moments of being in community simply weren't there. The second thing is that the nation was seeing a racial reckoning after the murder of George Floyd. I know that this board even made a very powerful statement regarding that situation. And so ultimately we've continued to see these kind of racialized incidents take place throughout the pandemic era. And even as we move into what people will refer to now as a close to being endemic era, where it is, you know, just a normal course of action, we're continuing at some point, maybe this summer or fall, everything will be quote unquote back to normal-ish. Maybe we won't even be wearing masks anymore, right? But ultimately, the effects of 2 years of loss of life, of strife, of trauma, of difficult work conditions, of all this pressure, it has an impact not just on the students, but also on the educators who serve them. And oftentimes when I meet with educators, whether it's at my own institution or even here, especially those who've been working most closely with students over this period, they're asked to be a rock of support for them when sometimes they feel like they themselves are nothing more than a bag of pebbles because of the exhaustion and tiredness that can come with that work. Part of what we know too is that during this time frame, we switched to more virtual learning. And virtual learning is a great opportunity for some students. And for some students, it's not the easiest thing to do. There's differences in terms of access to technology, proficiency in technology. And so we talk about this in terms of digital equity. We need to, and we are, and this is something that we believe, ensuring that all students, regardless of their identities or circumstances, can participate in the virtual learning space in ways that will be value added to achieving their personal and academic goals. Special attention must be given to digital equity and that students must have access to the technology and technological knowledge they need to seamlessly access and make meaningful contributions to the virtual learning space. And so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to turn it over to my colleague, Dr. Harris, and he's going to talk a little bit about equity and that notion of, again, having a heightened focus on groups that experience disproportionate impact, but also why we should care about that in terms of the work that we do. And then also thinking about, as a board, how do we move forward in facilitating these conversations and change so we can see all of our students learn, grow, develop, and be successful.
Yeah, thank you so much for getting us started, Dr. Wood. I want to thank President Murillo and all the board of trustee members for just creating this space for us to have an important dialogue. Grateful for the opportunity to be here and play somewhat of an important role in this conversation. So we have found in our work that educators can tell you what equity is. They can define it, right? They have a good sense of what it is, but that doesn't necessarily mean that they actually care about it. And in fact, even as we unpack and talk about some of the elements and concepts of equity and disproportionate impact, there still may be colleagues who are wondering, why should we care about this? Why are we spending so much time and so many valuable resources invested in equity? And so we offer what we think are four pretty compelling reasons as to why we all need to be concerned about equity. And first is that we have to recognize that if we're talking about access to post-secondary education, particularly for students who've been underrepresented and underserved, community colleges are really the primary pathway to post-secondary education. And so really the implication there is that we recognize that we're talking about all of the students who, the student groups that Luke identified as typically being disproportionately impacted, most of those students are starting their educational careers at a community college, right? They're at a place more likely to be at a Santa Barbara City College than they would be at a UC Santa Barbara or a San Diego State, at least to start. And so really the implication here is that if we don't get it right in the community colleges, if we don't have equity and outcomes in our community colleges, then there's often no other opportunity to redress those concerns, right? So it really starts here. Second, we also have to, we often talk with our faculty colleagues, our educator colleagues, is that we have to recognize that the paradigm of student success and the way most of us were trained to work with students, to teach students and advise students, it was based on some assumptions about student success that really are no longer valid and no longer meet the needs of the present or the current student population. Today's student population are more likely to be working, to be adult learners, to be attending part-time, while having other significant responsibilities outside of education. And so the way that we think about student success, the way that we actually design learning experiences to achieve student success has to be reconsidered. And so we often juxtapose the traditional paradigm, which most of us are kind of either experienced or socialized to embrace. And we often compare that to what we call the equity paradigm. We also have to recognize this, and I usually don't like to start with this reason, right? But I think it's important to acknowledge is that when you talk to most of the country's top economists, they often say, they have said for well over a decade now, that if we expect to really continue to meet our country's social and economic needs, we simply have to have a more college-educated population, right? And we have to have a more college-educated population in the sense that we need many of our adult learners, those ages 25 to 34-year-olds, to have some kind of college degree, credential, or certificate. Some predicted by the year 2020, and you know, certainly the pandemic really played a role in us really not achieving that outcome. Others have predicted 2025. Before the pandemic, we were not on pace to reach a 60% educational attainment outcome for adult learners until the year 2048. And we know the pandemic has probably extended that by several years at a minimum. We also know that when we have fewer college-educated workers, that means lower tax revenue, that means increased poverty, that means lower annual household incomes, and it means that it has an adverse effect on all of us who live and work in this country. And then lastly, you have to recognize that if this is our goal, that we can ill afford to have throwaway groups, right? We can no longer say, hey, as long as my group, my family, my community is making it, I need not be worried about another. And so we can ill afford to do that. Lastly, we often say this as well, is that as educators or those, our trustee members, as those who play a governing role, a leadership role in education, we have a tremendous responsibility as educators, right? And that is, we have an opportunity and an obligation to create learning environments that are safe, that are welcoming, that are inclusive, that contribute to student success, right? And it's sort of the obligation and the responsibility that we have by holding the roles that we have in this space, regardless of what it may be. We also often talk about barriers to equity, in particular racial equity. And we're not gonna spend a lot of time on this other than to say that, you know, there are a handful of reasons that we often come across in our work, having worked with, you know, literally hundreds of institutions, mostly community colleges over the past decade or so. And so we're not gonna talk about all of these, but we do wanna highlight some that tend to be incredibly salient. The first is when we have deficit perspectives, when we believe that certain groups of students are smarter or not smart or more deserving or not deserving or so forth, in terms of actually having access to higher education, but also being a part of it. Yeah. We have some educators who really do believe that certain groups of students, right? Students who look like me and students who look like Luke, for example, are not as smart as other students and not as capable as other students. And so we often say deficit perspectives are self-fulfilling prophecies. So as educators, we know that if we have a student who we believe doesn't belong in our classes or doesn't belong at our college, then we're less likely to put forth the full motivation and energy and effort that it takes to really serve that student in the way that they deserve to be served. We also recognize that we have some of us who have a poor conceptualization of what equity is. There are some educators who believe equity is about lowering rigor and lowering standards. Let's just make it easy for certain groups of students to get in and get through. And what we often say is this: when we're equity focused in our work, it should be easier for students. But it should be easier not because we're lowering rigor and lowering standards, but it should be easier because we're identifying and eliminating institutional barriers that often get in the way of student success and progress. And then lastly, we often talk about racially toxic and equity deprived institutional cultures, which I'm gonna talk about in just a few minutes. Before I do that, we also talk about the perspectives that educators bring as being very significant and important. This is a taxonomy that Luke and I developed probably 10 years ago or so, maybe not quite that long. But we developed it to help us kind of make sense of the range of perspectives that we often encounter in our work with colleges as it relates to equity. Those of you who've seen Luke and I present before, you've probably seen this before, so bear with us. But we find that when it comes to being able to really be equity-centered and equity-focused in our work as educators, that there are really two constructs that often come into play. The first one we describe as competence. It's simply knowing what to do. As an educator, I know what equity is, I know what equity mindedness is, and I know how to be equity minded in my work as a faculty member, as an advisor, whatever it is, I know how to do that work from an equity perspective. But we also know this, and I think we can all agree, and any of you who have teenage kids, you're certainly gonna agree with what I'm about to say, that knowing how to do something in and of itself is necessary, but insufficient when it comes to actually doing it, right? Any teenage parents in here other than me, right? Would you agree with what I just said? Right. So this is where our second construct comes into play. And we can think about this as motivation, our willingness to actually employ equity mindedness and equity practices in our work. And so if we take the box that's labeled KW at the top right, this represents the perspective of educators who know what equity is, they know how to apply it in their work, and they're highly motivated to do it. They actually do it on a regular basis. And you know, perhaps predictably, we call this group the choir. And we often call this group the choir because more often than not, it's the choir that's leading equity efforts and equity conversations on their campuses, right? These are the folks who are saying, hey, you know, there's this new book that we should all read that can help us be better at teaching math from an equity-minded perspective, right? Or there's this new webinar that's going to be made available. Let's all come together and watch it and see what practices we can draw from that and figure out how we can better inform and support the work that we're doing, and so forth. So, and that's the choir. Now, there's also some other stakeholders here that we have to be mindful of, like the allies, for example. The only thing that separates the allies from the choir is that the allies haven't had the opportunity to really learn what equity is and what it's about and how to do it. But they're highly motivated. They care about students. They care about student success. They care about the college. They want to see the college do well in terms of serving all students. They just haven't had the opportunity to learn what equity is and to really learn how to do it, right? They haven't had conversations like the one we're having today, where we can really start to think about what are some equity-focused practices and why are they important. But if you give them the opportunity to learn it and build their capacity to be equity-focused, they could just as easily become a part of the choir. Now, there's some other groups that we have to be mindful of, like the resistors. We have found in our work that there are two types of resistors on most campuses: active resistors and passive resistors. Active resistors are those who are the most vocal and forthcoming about their opposition and disdain for equity. So these are the folks who are saying, why are we doing this? This is a waste of time. This is a waste of money. Who's Luke Wood and Frank Harris? Get them off our campus. These guys are frauds. They have no idea what they're talking about or what they're doing, right? But we find that for the most part, most resistors are actually not active resistors. We may often think that they are because they kind of represent a vocal minority, but most resistors are what we would describe as passive resistors, meaning they're not going to be as vocal, they're not going to be as forthcoming about their dislike or disdain for equity, but they're also not going to be meaningfully engaged in anything that has to do with equity, unless they absolutely have to be. And then we have the defiant. These are the folks who have been trained. They understand what equity is. They have a very good understanding of what it is, but they refuse to enact equity practices, at least with the students who need to support the most. So they're not necessarily concerned about disproportionate impact. They're not concerned about what the college data says about who needs more support and who needs a more intentional focus or more intentional effort. That's not their concern. They might be more willing to be more intrusive or be more relational with the students that they like, or maybe the students who work in their, you know, their department, or maybe students who maybe they know their parents, but they're not at all concerned about students who are disproportionately impacted. And so I'm going to skip ahead here. There's some other perspectives here that, you know, just for the sake of time, I'm going to skip ahead because there's another component of this that I want to make sure we talk about. Is that a few years ago, maybe certainly before the pandemic, so maybe closer to 3 years ago, Luke and I found ourselves pretty frustrated because we were doing a lot of intentional, deep and intentional work with colleges. And we would find that some colleges, things would be taken off, right? They spend a lot of time examining their policies, examining their practices. They were doing a lot of good stuff. A lot of the things that we have known to have an impact on changing institutions to be more equity focused. And in some places, those efforts would be, we would see, you know, clear indicators of progress. And then we would have another campus that would be doing the same thing as the first campus, but we wouldn't necessarily see the same indicators of progress. So we spent some time thinking about that, reflecting on that. And we finally, you know, sort of had some of an epiphany. I'm actually embarrassed to call it an epiphany when we think about, well, why are things working so well here and not working so well at this other place? And the epiphany is this, right? Peter Drucker, those who study business, you're probably familiar with Peter Drucker, but he talked about this a long time ago. that culture eats strategies for breakfast, right? Anybody ever seen this quote, right? I think about it all the time. And we recognized in that moment that the reason why some campuses were having success and other campuses were not necessarily having the same success is that some campuses actually had an institutional culture that was actually aligned with their equity goals and what they wanted to do and what they wanted to become with regard to advancing equity. And so we like to create taxonomies. We created another taxonomy that kind of accounts for the interplay between institutional culture and institutional strategy. And so the question is, well, what exactly is an institution's culture, right? What does it look like? How do we know what culture is, right? And we see some evidence and some examples of it. I won't, talk about all these. But an institution's culture, is reflected in its leadership, both who's a part of the leadership, but also how the leadership leads, its mission, its values, its embedded practices, which we don't always think about, right? Every institution has embedded practices. And those are the practices that play a huge role in how business and work is conducted at the institution, but they're not necessarily codified or written down anywhere, right? That often plays a huge role in shaping an institution's culture. And we see some other evidence there as well. And then there's strategies, right? And I'm gonna go back one slide. We have found that for the most part, when we look at what most institutions have historically done to become more equity focused, most of what institutions have historically done has not necessarily focused on these things. What they have focused on are more so what we would identify as strategies. Equity planning and, do we have a good guided pathways process? And are we using multiple measures to assess students? And, do we have a robust offering of a set of professional development offerings? And are we disaggregating our data and so forth? And by no means are we saying that strategies are not important. Strategies are incredibly important. And strategies are necessary really to move a campus towards being more equity centered. But what we will say is that strategies in and of themselves and strategies at the absence of really addressing institutional culture really doesn't get an institution where it hopes to be and where it needs to be when it comes to institutionalizing equity. And so, for example, when we think about going back to culture, we have found that an institution can have a culture that is either equity enriched or equity deprived. Now, the fact of the matter is this. There's probably a lot more in between there, right? We're sort of presenting it as this binary either or, but it's probably a lot more fluid than how it shows up here on a slide. But then when we ask ourselves, well, what does an equity enriched culture look like? And what does an equity deprived culture look like? And here's some examples of some indicators of both, right? So on the left are examples of what we would describe as an equity enriched culture. And on the right are examples of what we would describe as an equity deprived culture. And so, when we look at number three, for example, when equity is seen as an indicator of what an institution does and not exclusively as an indicator of what a student does, then that might be indicative of an equity enriched culture, right? Now, listen, this is not a checklist. It's not to say that if, there's actually a total of 10 of these, it's not to say if you have, 8 out of the 10, you're good. And if you have fewer than that, then you're not so good. But these are just indicators. These are things that we can look to and pay attention to that might give us a sense of where we are in terms of institutionalizing equity. But take a look at number six. When we have leadership that is public, transparent, and unapologetic about prioritizing equity, as opposed to being fearful or shameful to embrace equity, that might be indicative of an equity-enriched culture. Again, it's another example of that. And then you see, there's some other indicators as well. Now, what about strategies? So we have found that an institution can either have good strategy or bad strategy when it comes to actually institutionalizing equity. When we were putting this together, we really kind of struggled with this because we were kind of sort of like, well, what's better, bad strategy or no strategy? And ultimately, we kind of landed that we would rather an institution have no strategy than to have bad strategy, just simply based on the whole premise of do no harm, right? Because you could actually do real harm, right, with bad strategies. Well, you could, now I think about this, you could probably do harm with no strategies as well. So anyhow, that's probably a conversation for the next meeting. But let's just go with this, right? Good strategy or bad strategy? Well, what are some examples of good strategies and what are some examples of bad strategies? You see here, good on the left, bad on the right. Look at number three. Historically, when we think about, you know, I've been working with community colleges since 2005. And I can tell you, you know, around that time when we talked about professional development on a campus, for the most part, the folks that got professional development were your full-time faculty and your managers, for the most part, never classified professionals and never ever adjunct faculty or part-time faculty. Now I can say that most campuses do a much better job of making sure that everybody has access to high impact professional development, right? So that's a strategy that seems to have, you know, sort of made its way to most places. But look at number eight, for example. Do we have intentional efforts and spaces where we could actually have difficult and critical conversations about race, racism, and racial equity? Or is it when we have these conversations, if they're happening, are they muted and disconnect or completely disconnected from equity? You know, I can say again, Dr. Woody and I have literally visited hundreds of campuses over the last decade. We can tell you most campuses are, you know, probably more so on the right when it comes to this strategy than what you see here on the left, on the good strategy. And so that's something where that's an area where most institutions have some work to do. But going back to our taxonomy, right? You can have an equity enriched culture and be applying the right strategy. And this is obviously where every institution wants to be, right? We could also, you know, be in a place where we don't necessarily have the right culture, but we are applying the right strategies. And I'm gonna tell you what happens when we're there. This is a place where no one wants to be, obviously, right? Bad culture, bad strategy. No one wants to be here. And then here, right? Sometimes we have the right culture, but we just aren't applying the right strategies. Now, I'm gonna say this before I advance to the next slide. This is something I probably should have said earlier. So this taxonomy, we're thinking about this as an institution, right? As Santa Barbara City College, for example, as an institution. But this same taxonomy applies to divisions and units within an institution as well. And so everything I'm saying here about an institution, you might be able to say about a division of student affairs, for example, or an academic affairs, or a particular, you know, academic division or so forth. And so we have to recognize and you know, understand that, like most institutions are, you know, in many ways, a collection of institutions or organizations within it. So that's just something to be mindful of. But what happens when we have right strategy, right culture, we're likely going to be very effective when it comes to actually institutionalizing equity. Equity is going to be a core part of the institution's identity. It's not just going to be in its mission statement. You're going to see it reflected in its curriculum, in its hiring policies. You're going to see goals, strategic planning goals that are directly aligned with its equity goals and so forth, right? And so, this is where most institutions want to be when it comes to equity. But, you know, what happens when we're here? All the right strategies, but, you know, if we don't really have the culture that gets us what we need, then most of what you're going to see at this institution when it comes to equity is going to be externalized. So there'll be equity things happening over here, over there, but it's never really going to be, it's never going to penetrate what we call the institutional core. Right, it'll never be a central discussion when we're talking about hiring or curriculum or strategic planning or budget. I often focus on those are sort of the big four, right? When we talk about what really drives an institution, hiring, strategic planning, budget, and curriculum, right, are sort of the big four there, right? And then, you know, if we're here, we might actually see some evidence here and there in terms of equity being central and institutionalized in some ways, but we're not necessarily going to know why or how it happened, and we're certainly not going to be able to replicate it in other places, in other spaces. And if we're here, we're going to be completely inept, right, when it comes to institutionalizing equity. Now, to further muddy the waters, right, I know some folks are probably thinking, oh, okay, I can kind of see, I can plot where we are, right, on this, but the reality really looks more like this at most campuses. Some campuses are great when it comes to maybe Pell eligible students or first generation students, and completely inept when it comes to adult learners or men of color, right? So this is what the reality looks like at most places. I like to think, and we have found that no institution is always effective right? Some institutions are effective for some students on some issues and inept for some students and on some issues, right? So we really have to think about this in a very fluid way. And so some folks are thinking, okay, well, what exactly should we do about this? Well, you know, I think first and foremost, if we're talking about equity and if we're talking about racial equity in particular, then we have to commit to being an anti-racist organization, first and foremost, right? Part of that might mean or could mean is that first and foremost, we look at all of our policies and practices with the goal of identifying those that create and sustain racial inequity. Whether it's a task force, whether it's something that we do institutionally, how it's done, you know, that could matter. But the fact that it's an institutional priority is something that we commit to, is something that is done with intention, is what's most important, right? And then we think about, you know, leadership in terms of, you know, hiring and setting equity goals for programs and departments and divisions and assessing the racial climate, right? Which we know this college has recently done not too long ago, and identifying points of intervention and you know, thoroughly and meaningfully investigating issues of bias and discrimination. And then making sure that professional learning is something that happens as well. We also have to do what we call lift minoritized voices. We have found that most colleges and most institutions, those who are most disproportionately impacted or those who are having an inequitable or you know, racially hostile experience could actually tell you exactly what they're experiencing and are very transparent about what they're experiencing. The problem is their voices are usually marginalized and muted as well. And so most campuses say, if this is something that you're really serious about, then take the time to seek the voices and perspectives of those who are disproportionately impacted, those who have experienced racism, for example, and ask them, what's it like to be here? And how's it impacting your health and well-being? And how's it limited the advancement of your career? And how can we be a better institution, right? Those are important questions. Maybe even more importantly, or just as important as actually believing what they say. We've seen a lot of, we've seen some colleges that are engaged in this type of effort and they're not happy with what they find or they're concerned about how it may look. And they actually pretend as if the inquiry never happened, which is one of the worst things you can do as an institution, right? So we say you use this as an opportunity to become a better institution. You make the findings public and you start to come up with institutional actions that make you a better institution. We also have to think about, you know, how do we address inequity, racial inequity in the context of teaching and learning? We have found is that, you know, there's sort of, you know, some pretty consistent patterns here, particularly when it comes to racially minoritized and disproportionately impacted students, invisible when it comes to curriculum, invisible when it comes to those who are actually teaching and leading instruction, but you know, hyper-visible when it comes to experiencing microaggressions, or hyper-visible when it comes to being, say, the only person of color in a STEM course and things of that nature, right? And so we have to be mindful of that. Student services, there's some work to do there as well. In most cases, the three patterns that we see here is where students are underserved, under-challenged, and unwelcome, are the big three there. And so just really thinking about, you know, how do we address these is, you know, are these reflected in our practices? Are these reflected in the ways in which our students experience our student services? HR is another area that typically needs some attention in most places. So thinking about, you know, how do we have inequity in the ways in which we develop position descriptions or how we compose hiring committees or how we assess applicants? And if we have campus visits and forums, do those breed some inequity in one way or another? And then how do we handle employee grievances and performance evaluations? It's also some areas of inquiry. And then, you know, we have to really think about, you know, looking at this with a comprehensive strategy. We have to be very strategic about this, right? And so we appreciate about this meeting is that it's an opportunity to talk with members of the governing board, those who are in a position to actually, you know, require some institutional action to address concerns and issues related to inequity. Those that could say and set an agenda that says, hey, we want to know what's going on, right? We want to see the data and we want to see progress on the data as it continues to be collected, right? And staying consistently engaged in this issue. And so we thought it might be helpful to sort of, you know, as we conclude, we have these questions that can guide our conversation, or if there are questions that we can address or things we can clarify, we'd be happy to do that. But at some point we would encourage, you know, members of our board of trustees to ask, you know, what is your vision for equity as a board for this college? What are the most significant barriers to advancing equity from your perspectives? What do you see as your role as members of the governing board? And then how can we, so Luke and I will be working with the college for, you know, at least as long as Dr. Murillo invites us to, what are some ways in which we can support the college in advancing equity? So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yep.
And I'm gonna, before I go to the board, I'm going to pause for just a moment and recognize that this is my first time running a hybrid meeting. And in so doing, I could see that we did not have public comment in the room, but there may have been public comment online. So I just wanna pause and turn to Mr. Fales up in the booth for a moment and see if we have any public comment at all. And I'm seeing a shaking head of no. Okay, so no raised hands. Mr. Fales, just jump in if that changes. Thank you. And with that, I'm going to go ahead and turn this over to the board. There were some questions that they had up on the screen that could guide this conversation, or if there's anything that has come up as we've listened to these two gentlemen. If you want to jump in, just let me know. And I'm going to have to ask Mr. Fales to let me know if Trustee Gallardo would like to jump in. All right, Trustee Everett.
Well, first of all, I want to apologize to everyone. I was late because there was traffic and a traffic accident on the highway. So that said, it is kind of interesting being at our first in-person meeting. So yeah, it's nice to see folks again face-to-face. I wanted to thank you for your presentation, and I really have two comments and then a question. The first comment is what I appreciate about your presentation, particularly the rubrics, but mainly is the rhetoric and the words, because words and rhetoric matter. So I think the ways in which you're framing some of the issues are important. So that's the first comment. And the second comment is I like the idea of thinking about those of us who are committed as the choir and those who are, you know, sort of in the room and, you know, could or, you know, be interested as allies, because there are ways in which we can, you know, bring them to the choir and maybe have them sign up. The comment I wanted to make is that I really appreciate that, but I also think that the choir needs preaching to as well, because they can backslide, you know? So I think it's really kind of a good way to think about some of the ways that we can engage. My question has to do with the politicization of DEI most recently, and how can we think about ways to address the more efficient resistors, you know, who deploy CRT?
Yeah.
So that's what I have for the moment, but I really appreciate the questions as well.
Yeah, should we reply?
Yeah, feel free to respond, and then I'll move on to the next person.
Yeah, of course. Thank you, Trustee Everett, for your question. And I think you're right. DEI work has been recently politicized in some pretty strategic ways. But the fact of the matter is DEI work has been around a long time. And there was a time when it wasn't as politicized as it is now. And it has always been important work. And what I like to say is that DEI work is really about being an effective institution and being an institution that is committed to doing what most institutions say they endeavor to do, and that's to provide access to education to its community. And if we're talking about community colleges, we're talking about open access institutions where anyone who can demonstrate that they have the benefit, that they can benefit from the opportunity, is welcome here and deserves to be here. And so if that's our mission as a community college, and if equity is a part of that, providing an equitable and inclusive institution, then we have to be intentionally invested in DEI work. And it has to be depoliticized, because it's not just about, you know, I know every, you know, at the risk of sounding naive, I know every issue can be politicized, but we have to be focused on, you know, can we be the best college and the college of choice for those in our community who need access to post-secondary education and those who need it so that they can improve the quality of their lives, the quality of life for their families that are counting on them. And more importantly, they can contribute to a thriving Santa Barbara County. And so I don't necessarily see that as inherently political. I think it's about being the best institution that we can be and ultimately being the best educators that we can be. And the best educational leaders and trustees that you all can be. And so it's a matter of just being responsible.
Thank you.
Yep.
Student Trustee Diallo.
Yeah, thank you again. And sorry, I also came in late. And thank you for the presentation. It was very informative. And my question or comment have to do with insecurity.
Yeah.
Like as a student, like if you have undocumented student or student of color or any student that belong to a group of minorities, they feel insecure to, you know, ask for help sometimes, like getting basic needs or getting support in a lot of things that students of color face. So I want to know, like, because what I envision is equity-mindedness can be like a right and not as a privilege. So instead of having like certain departments or institutions that direct you and, you know, specifically say, if you are a minority or if you are disabled, you should go to this place for help. Now, I think a better way would be to make it something as a right to the general public, that anyone who needs certain help or support should go there instead of just directing it to someone who is a minority, because they will feel insecure about going there because people may probably judge them, saying this person goes to the department because of who they are, of what they are going through. So I don't know if you have any advice on how, from the student's perspective, to address insecurities, to make them feel safe, that they can ask for, you know, certain support and get access to certain programs without being judged or being labeled or classified as someone unfortunate.
Yeah, thank you, Trustee Diallo, for your question. I would say we share your perspective. Students shouldn't have to ask for help, right? We should have help built into every aspect of the student experience. And it shouldn't necessarily be called help, to be honest with you. So for example, when we talk about basic needs and insecurities, so students who struggle with you know, not having access to healthy and nutritious food on a regular basis. Yeah, you could have a food pantry, and a lot of colleges have food pantries. And the idea is that, you know, if you're struggling with you know, food insecurity, go to the basic needs, I mean, go to the food pantry. That's one way to do it. Another way to do it is just to have healthy and nutritious snacks spread out throughout the campuses where, you know, so in this, if students are going to be in a student union, you know, have fruit and granola bars and trail mix and things like that. And in that way, it's just something that whether you're experiencing a food insecurity, you have access to it, but maybe you aren't experiencing a food insecurity, but you were late getting to campus because you had a hard time parking, or, you know, your kid was sick and you got them late, you were sort of rushing to get them to school before you came to campus. And so we really do have to think, our colleagues in disability who do work around disability and accessibility call it universal design, right? And so I think we have to really think about our equity work from a universal design perspective, in a sense that it can be done to meet the needs of students who are disproportionately impacted, but it also can be done in a way to make the experience easy for all students, regardless of their status, if they're disproportionately impacted or not. And I want to be careful. I'm not advocating a, you know, sort of equity for all approach. I think with equity, you have to be intentional and you have to address disproportionate impact. But I do think there's a way that once you recognize that there is disproportionate impact, the next step is to make whatever supports are in place from an institution, make them easy to access. Don't make it to where you have to, you know, take another two or three steps, right? Or to disclose things unnecessarily in order to get the help that's needed. As a matter of fact, I think if I could offer one example, I apologize. Where I thought most community colleges in California did a really good job of this is with the HERF funding and the COVID relief funds. What a lot of colleges did was this, is they said, okay, every student who's enrolled at the college this semester, who's enrolled in a certain number of units, we're not gonna ask if you need money, if you don't need money, we're gonna just send you a check for a certain amount of money, right? And we know that those funds were, that they were incredibly important and really played a role for students who really needed the help and the support, but they didn't have to fill out a form. They didn't have to go to financial aid. They didn't have to take a bunch of extra steps in order to access the funding, right? I think that's an example of how we might need to think more strategically about how do we embed our equity work into what we do, into our day-to-day practices as a college. And there's other examples of that if, you know, others care to know, but yeah, we would agree with you.
Other board members, Trustee Miller.
Thank you for your presentation. It was a lot to absorb. and I suppose if we had more time, we would focus on specific items, but it was very helpful for us. I've been on the board for 4 years, and I would say my views have certainly changed on DEI since I've been here, to the point that I would say today that SBCC will not succeed as an institution without a strong and consistent focus on DEI. It's just what we should be about. So I'm very interested in knowing what action you may have identified in your earlier meetings that we should be undertaking. Is there something that we're not doing that you have spotted that we should be doing?
Yeah, thank you, Trustee Miller. We had a lot of great and informative and insightful conversations with a range of stakeholders at the college. What we consistently heard is that the college has a reputation of saying that it's committed to DEI, right, broadly defined, but that commitment is not necessarily reflected in how it acts and goes about its business, right? Particularly when it comes to things like hiring, things like, you know, evaluating the performance of employees, really when we're talking about, you know, systems of accountability and actually policies and practices that impact how folks work. So, you know, just again, we were only here one day, and it's very difficult to really get to know an institution after a full day visit. But if we had to make a decision, if sort of say, you know, this, we know that this is the last time we get to visit, what should we do? That's where we would encourage you to focus on.
In other words, there's a disconnect between what we say and what we do.
Yeah. Yep.
Trustee Haslund.
I'll join the chorus and say thank you for sharing what you've accomplished, sharing your research. I thought you had some creative thinking going on. I'm a former classroom teacher, and so my question derives from a faculty position. And I'd recognize in class that someone who is who I would suspect would need some help, person of color. And when my automatic response was to try to engage in conversation, not necessarily in public, but in conversation so as to just to learn more about what that student was hearing, seeing, feeling. And sometimes I discovered that there was no receptivity. There was an absence of trust, basically. So in some instances, I was unsuccessful in in moving those barriers one way or another. Is that similar to what you've experienced?
Well, you know, we often hear, some of the earlier work that Luke and I was engaged in was focused on men of color in community colleges, primarily Black and Latino men who attended colleges a lot like Santa Barbara City College. And we would often hear from educators, many of whom did not identify as men of color, sort of say, hey, I really want to help my students. I want all my students to succeed, but I have a hard time engaging and connecting with my men of color, right? How do I do that? What do I do? Or I've tried to do it and they're not responsive. And so, you know, we think the first thing that most educators have to do is somehow establish some rapport and helping students understand that you are as invested in their, you're invested in their success, right? So the idea here is that, yeah, this is your, you know, this is your experience, right? You're the student in this situation, but I see your success in this class as an indication of my effectiveness as an educator. So I want to be a real partner in this, right? So establishing that this is a real partnership, and that if you're not successful, then I feel like I haven't really fully met my needs and met my expectations as an educator. Is a big part of that, right? We also know this, and I think, for example, when we talk about men of color, and we could probably broaden this beyond men of color, is that you know, most educational environments, is going back even as far as early childhood in some cases, you know, haven't been the most welcoming or the most rewarding contexts and experiences. And educators within those spaces haven't exactly been the friendliest of people who have demonstrated a consistent investment in their success. And so by the time they get into community college, the average age for a man of color in community college, for example, is, you know, mid to late 20s. So they have, you know, many years, 20 plus years in most cases, of having experienced an educational environment, having had an educational experience that hasn't been positive, that hasn't been good, that's been largely negative. And so, you know, sometimes I think we have to think about this experience and where they are from their perspectives, exercise a little bit more patience, exercise a little bit more grace, not give up, you know, after one or two attempts, but, you know, sort of stay with them and say, you know, I'm going to continue to reach out. And, you know, even if I don't hear from you, there's still an opportunity. The door will always be open, right? And so that... that often takes time, that often takes a lot of intentionality. I would say most educators are not trained to do that, you know, which is why a lot of the work that Luke and I do is literally, you know, before the pandemic, was flying around the country to visit community colleges, to have conversations with colleagues about how do you effectively build relationships with disproportionately impacted students, and what are the actual practices that we know that impact their success in a positive way. And so that's, I'm sorry, I don't know if I answered your question. I kind of feel like I'm rambling now bit. Yeah, I think that's.
I appreciate your response. It wasn't all of the time. I mean, right. I met with a lot of students over 40 years. You meet a lot of students, but once in a while, mm-hmm. that would happen, and it always puzzled me. Obviously, I appreciate your comment with respect to my understanding of why the absence of trust, and it's very real, and perhaps patience over time is, and receptivity to having an open office door is a good mm-hmm. thing to do.
Yeah. You know, and I'll say this, we had a conversation with some faculty colleagues part of the visit today. And we, you know, we started to talk about expectations, right? And sometimes as a student, when you've experienced, you know, an educational system that has basically conditioned you to expect little to nothing from it, even when someone offers you help and support, sometimes you don't even think that you deserve that. Or that, you know, like, where is this coming from? What's this about, right? And so sometimes it could be challenging to take advantage of, not take advantage, but to actually lean into that. Like, well, somebody's here to help me and support me, because everything that I've experienced up until this point has told me not to expect that, not to expect anything from educators other than a difficult time. And so when you have someone who's actually trying to approach it and try to offer a different experience, sometimes it takes time to actually build the trust, because I have years and years of history and experience that has taught me to not trust anything that happens here. As a matter of fact, to expect things at some point to go wrong, right? And, you know, I think that's sort of, to bring this full circle, that's part of what we mean when we say, you know, if we're really, really invested in equity as an institution, students have to really feel it, right? We have to, it's not just about us saying it. It's not even just about us, you know, telling faculty and staff to do this, but you have to feel it when you're on campus that, you know, this is a place for me, I belong here. This place has been intentionally designed for my success. And that's when we talk about culture and everything that we spent some time talking about.
Thank you.
Yes.
Other board members, I'm happy to jump in now if I don't have a raised hand, and I will. A couple things that I wanted to bring up. One was, thank you so much to Trustee Everett for bringing up your point about this highly charged environment that we find ourselves in this moment in the early 2020s, talking about DEI work, how politicized it's become, how people jump to their corners on it. And I really, from my experience here at SBCC, I believe that the people that work here, that they believe in the mission of the college. And I believe that that they are all working towards reducing disproportionate impact, and that they care about their students coming through. And what I see sometimes, though, is this just lack of being able to talk about it. There are different approaches to DEI work. There are things to discuss and question. But what I've seen instead is that sometimes it just becomes attacks and shutting down. And that is not what we want to model in this college community. And I hope that you can help us as we work through this, figure out ways to keep dialogue going with people that maybe what they're trying to express is that they think we're taking the wrong approach, but they want the same outcome. So I really hope that you can facilitate that with us, because that's something that I've seen as a challenge here. And then the other thing, I really wanted to appreciate you bringing up that marriage of culture and strategy. And in the many years that I've been working in education, I have seen both things, like both extremes go wrong, where people, you know, they come forward with the best of intentions with what they think are the best strategies, and they have not included the communities that are impacted. And in so doing, they do things that really harm those communities. And that's been frustrating to see, and it was lessons learned on my part, for sure. Sometimes I've also seen ones where the culture becomes everything and they're hyper-focused on kind of individual work instead of looking at the institutional. There's no strategies. They're not disaggregating the data. They're not looking at long-term. They're, you know, and I'm a very practical person. And so I really do want those numbers to shift. I want our kids to come out. I want to be able to point to something at the end of my time here and say, look at how this has helped our students. And so to me, it is really that joining together that is really critical. And again, I'm so pleased that we have people here working with us that have community college expertise. It is, you know, sometimes you're looking at the national conversation and you're reading the New York Times or whatever, and it's really not about community colleges, which are their own unique thing. And so I think you bring a unique perspective that will really help us with our unique perspective So thank you. And I look forward to what's coming up for us. I think it's exciting and something that we've really needed to do.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Trustee Parker. You know, Luke and I work at a university. I've been at San Diego State for 15 years. Luke has been there maybe not much less than that, but we've probably spent most of our time at community colleges. Before the pandemic, certainly so, maybe less so now. But community colleges are the most important educational institutions in our country right now, as far as we're concerned. And we're biased in saying that, right? And our K-12 colleagues would certainly, you know, take some issue and exception to that. But, you know, just the open access mission, the opportunity to access programs and, you know, build your skills as your transferable skills or your tangible skills that could actually lead to a better quality of life. You know, where else do you get to do that? And so we're really invested in the community colleges for those reasons. But this is a very important institution for the future vitality of our country, whether you're talking about education, economic, social. We have to get it right in our community colleges, or I don't know what we'll do.
Any other comments from board members? Yes, Trustee Abboud.
I'll just comment. Look, there's just a couple things. I think the first one is that in the past, I don't feel that the board has made this the top priority, but we have for the last 3 years. And so I think that's changed a lot, and we have to keep doing that. If we don't make it an issue, then the rest of the college won't. So I think we need to keep it as a top priority. And I really like the slide you had about why to do this and the types of groups to reach. And it is the right thing to do. It is also the economic thing that it makes our area more prosperous. And our college, we get our funding based on how successful our students are and the kinds of students we enroll. So us having a real way to engage those students is going to be helpful for us fiscally and to meet what we're designed to do. So I really like that slide on how you put that together, because yeah, it's the right thing to do and it's the economic thing to do. It's both. And that's the best, I guess it's best when you can marry both of those. So
thank you, Trustee Abboud. You know, this is not, it's a lot easier to present on a slide than it is to actually do the work. This is very challenging work. And there are going to be times when, you know, if you as a board, you prioritize and say, this is what we're about and this is what we're going to do, you're going to have folks that are going to challenge you on that.
Oh, yeah.
Right. And so that's when your support and your advocacy and your commitment is going to be most important. Right. During those times when folks are really challenging, why are we doing this, and accusing the college of advancing an agenda and, you know, all these things. And so we just ask that, you know, we want to be good partners in the work, and we, you know, we have tremendous respect and appreciation for President Murillo. And we know that she's the president that can get it done. We've seen it done before, but you really have to be committed to the work, authentically committed to the work, even when it's hard and inconvenient. And so if we're going to be partners in the work and we really want to be, that's something that we'll need from you all to really make the partnership worthwhile for all of us and to do the things that we all have said that we want to do on behalf of this college.
Thank you.
Just had a quick question, follow up. One of the slides you had said, you know, one of the best things we can do, not best, but one of the good things we can do is to have a serious look at our policies at that anti-racist level. And we did start that, and me and Trustee Parker were on a bigger task force that was looking at those. And we actually found some good changes to make. Yes. Like, you know, we gave the Emoji program higher class registration priority, but then we didn't finish that work. And so is that something that you all would be helping us with? Or, because I think that's one thing we're struggling with, is like, how do we operationalize that review and get it done? Because we had a good time doing it, but it didn't get done and we wanted to get done.
Yeah, we could certainly do that. Your policies and procedures really, I mean, they set the course for what we do as a college. So that's an important place to be. And probably a good, if you've already started the work, and we've heard that that work has already started and some things have come out of that, but I would certainly, you know, pick that up and you know, really see how much more we can advance it, for sure.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
So speaking of your slides, one question I have is it possible to attach your slides to our agenda so that people can reference them in the future? I'm seeing some nods here.
Yes. Good. The only thing we would ask is if you could attach them as a PDF.
Yep. That'd be okay. Great.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to turn to Mr. Fales and double check, and he is shaking his head that there is no comment from online. Okay. And then maybe I'll turn to Dr. Murillo and see, like, if you could, and I'm somebody, I don't know if it's Dr. Wood, Dr. Harris, or you, just talk about what's going to be happening with their work at SBCC over the next, it's automatically on. Yeah.
Can I say
it's always
before?
On, huh?
Oh, and Trustee Everett, you wanted
just
to
do before that? The main thing I wanted to say was, you know, thank you very much, President Murillo, for organizing the special session, but also for really making it clear that DEIA is an important part of our mission beyond just it being a line in the mission statement, but that, you know, there's actually a commitment to enact and to, you know, make real and tangible and operationalize that commitment. So, but thank you for bringing them, you know, to the conversation.
Thank you.
And your leadership.
Thank you, Trustee Evan. DEIA, duly noted.
Got that from her.
Yeah.
We're doing that a lot. So we have a couple more groups that we want to invite Dr. Harris and Dr. Wood to meet with. We wanted to prioritize today our classified employees and management group and start the conversation with the task force for the DEIA and the board. We wanted to make sure that we had the conversation, and they really felt we needed to do this in person. So next, we've got a whole group that kind of a whole group again that we're still got to talk to. And so I will be looking to Dr. Wood and Dr. Harris to provide a sort of the roadmap, I guess, that we would start going down in advice on how we should start implementing some of this action. We know that policy and procedure is a big issue. And then we've started some hiring, and we've got to move forward with some more. And whatever they've heard in the last few days, plus whatever they're going to hear, because we still have other groups we have not been able to get into the room yet with them, like the College Planning Council, I think we have next week. And so once we do that, then we'll have all the input, and then we can sit down and start strategically laying out a framework together. And we'll invite them back because we want you to stay engaged in the dialogue. And I'm really sorry, Trustee Dalla and Allegra won't be here for all of this work. I want to introduce our student trustee up here. You want to stand up, Allegra? I can see you. I'm sorry. I'm Associated Student Government President, Student Trustee.
Thank you, Allegra. And I want to thank you and Trustee Diallo for your leadership. Your voices as students are so important. And we know that sometimes it's hard to find time to be in places like this, right? But you being here and you asking the right questions, asking the difficult questions, it makes a huge difference. So whoever's going to succeed you, please make sure that they pick up where you left off here. Thank you.
You may, but you need a mic. So Mr. Fales is heading down with one, I believe. It's always great. Great timing for batteries to die, right?
Check, check, check.
So yeah, thank you for the presentation. And I think it was really informative. And as an international student, I learned a lot, and I'm still like figuring out how, you know, to define DEI and how does that work. And I want to thank Dr. Murillo for putting that together and just making sure that every group is included and every voices are heard. My questions goes more towards international students, because I know you have experience. You went through like different colleges, and my question is more like, have you seen international students be impacted? Because I've been here since September 2019, and I have a different perspective. And then COVID happened, so my experience changed. And I believe maybe before, international students were not impacted by either academics, finances, or any related topic. But now we are more impacted than ever. And we can see that by the numbers of enrollment. So how do you help international students, and how international students are impacted, and where do they fall into this old strategy?
Yeah, wonderful question. Thank you, Allegra. So yeah, our work with and focus on international students typically shows up in the intersection. So if we're looking at, for example, racially minoritized students who could also be international students, students with disabilities, international students are typically not former foster youth, although I would imagine that that's, you know, certainly possible, and justice impacted students. And so we know, for example, even when we identify particular groups, there's an incredible amount of intersectionality that exists. And so we also know for international students, the pandemic had, you know, a huge adverse impact on enrollment. And even, you know, those who are here, even being able to get things like basic needs met, for example. And so enrollment is probably where we see it show up the most in terms of disproportionate impact, but it shows up in other ways as well, right? Even some of the things related to, you know, experiencing racism as people of color, right? Sometimes when you're a person of color on a campus, and you're sort of targeted with racism or racial microaggressions, the person who's doing it, they don't necessarily know that you're an international student or not, right? And so it sort of shows up in that way as well. But I appreciate your question. I think, you know, as Luke and I, and we know that Santa Barbara City College serves a critical mass of international students. And so I think as we look at data and disaggregate it, we will make sure we're looking intentionally at international students and our data tables and charts and things like that. Yeah, thank you.
So when we finish up all of that final group work, we will be conferring and then bringing back some information. I am going to be bringing the contract for Dr. Harris and Dr. Wood to the next official board meeting. And I will appreciate the board approving. I will tell you, I brought them here in advance, and I have to give our foundation kudos, because Jeff said they'd help us out if we weren't ready for the contract. So I don't spend money without having backup. I just want you to know that I am accountable. Anyway, really appreciate you, Dr. Harris and Dr. Wood. I sat up here today feeling like, okay, there's hope, and we've got a lot of work to do. So. And Allegra and Student Trustee Allo, thank you for all your honesty, for the straightforward way that you speak with us and you share who you are.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Murillo. Thank you, trustees. Thank you, colleagues. We are humbled and appreciative for the opportunity to engage you today. Thank you.
Great. Onward and upward. With that, if there is no objection from Trustee Gallardo online or from any of my trustees here on the dais with me, I'm going to go ahead and adjourn this meeting. We will meet again at our regular board meeting on Thursday, April 21st at 4 p.m. And until we meet again, that should be an in-person meeting. Yes. We may continue to do hybrid as needed, but we will mostly be in person. All right. Thank you.